Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadrow, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Tony D'Amicantonio. As Vice President, Staffing Practice Leader, Tony is responsible for the operational direction of the Staffing Practice Group. With over 100 clients across the country with varying business models in place, Tony ensures that the knowledge and capabilities of the service team stay in front of the constantly evolving industry. Tony manages the traditional insurance program placement as well as the unique operational best practice consultation that Odell Studner offers staffing clients. This consultative approach offers a complete understanding of how clients operate their business, which allows Tony and his team to excel at finding the right insurance program for them. This typically includes a loss-sensitive workers' compensation program, where Tony works with clients to turn workers' compensation into a profit center for their company. Tony's career with Odell Studner began in 2005. He served as Senior Account Executive before being promoted to his current role. He spent over 12 years cultivating knowledge and relationships in the staffing industry, mastering the complex details of workers' compensation and liability insurance. Today, Tony oversees $1 million in premiums within this space. Prior to joining Odell Studner, Tony served as account manager for Lyons Odell, where he worked exclusively with clients in the owned group captive arena. Previously, he was an account manager at ECBM. Tony graduated from Penn State University with a Bachelor of Arts in Telecommunications. He earned his Certified Insurance Consultant designation from the National Alliance for Insurance Education and Research, and his Associate in Risk Management designation from the Institute. Tony's interests include spending time with family, playing golf, and traveling. Today's webinar, Odell Studner's let's do an overview of Odell Studner before we go into the webinar section. Their mission is to consult and partner with forward-thinking employees and companies who understand taking proactive action reduces uncertainty, accelerates growth, increases profitability, and creates a competitive advantage. Additional facts about Odell Studner Staffing Practice Group. The staffing practice has over 110 clients, over $120 million in payroll, and $4 billion in payroll represented. It's the largest captive broker in the insurance space. And some differentiators include staff risk manager, data and analytics platform, and loss-sensitive specialty. Do you and your staff sales team find yourselves getting held up at the last minute in the sales process with a contract or insurance requirement? In today's Industry Insider webinar, Tony will provide you with a sound overview of three key areas of this process. First, he'll describe an overview of what Certificate of Insurance actually provides. Next, he'll focus on some of the commonly required additional coverage terms like additional insured status and the impact of providing those coverages on your insurance program. Finally, we'll cover an overview of different types of indemnification wording, what is best practice, implications of the various types of wording on your business. By the end of the session, you'll gain contractual insurance awareness and be ready for your next big sales deal. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A or chat features. After the presentation, there will be time for questions and an opportunity for you to give us your feedback on today's webinar by completing a short exit poll. With that, I will turn the floor over to Tony.
Thank you for such an awesome introduction there, Amanda. contractual insurance awareness for the sales process. It's kind of a mouthful for anything in the insurance world. We're used to detail, so I guess we're staying consistent there. But the reason why I chose this topic is because I wanted to find something that my client base has always historically told me is valuable for their organization. And rather than talk about the insurance marketplace or products out there or anything like that, wanted to make sure we could bring something of value to you folks so that hopefully at the end of this year your organization operates just a little better than before this webinar. So with that being said, Amanda again did a great job of teeing me up there, so I'm not going to spend much time boring you with some of the reinforcement here, but as Amanda mentioned, we do work with over 110 staffing firms around the country. We have a real specialty in the loss-sensitive space, so today all of our clients are either taking risk in their insurance program or positioning to take risk with our help, and our main differentiators that you see in front of you there are all ways that we support our clients in taking risk in their program the best possible way. Just to reinforce the mission of the group again, the idea that we need to do something different when it comes to workers' compensation other than just sitting there and let it take care of itself. A lot of you all know that workers' compensation, especially for a light industrial staffing company, can be the second largest expense on your financials there. And if you really want to take control of it and do something different, then it starts with addressing it and putting a goal in place. Amanda, again, covered a little bit about who I am. I was really the one who helped build our practice group as far as our proactive service model goes. I've been on the operations side for about 14 years with Odell Studner, and in the first year of a new role where I'm responsible for new business into the firm. So it just gives me a little bit of lens from both sides of the equation there. In addition to that, board member of the Mid-Atlantic Staffing Association. So we really are passionate about the staffing industry here and want to make sure that we're giving time, energy, effort, investment back into the industry. So with all that being said, as we get into the meat of this here today, the goal of this is to make sure that we can get a little more educated on a topic that all of you run into in your business. And if you're not part of the sales force of your organization, hopefully you can bring back some of the tips and tricks that you learned today to the sales force, all with the goal of making sure that insurance and contracts are never something that hold up new business from going through. And it's never something that becomes a logjam, last minute. That's the worst possible scenario for everybody. The client isn't happy, the staffing firm isn't happy, and your insurance broker certainly isn't happy being the one who, sometimes can be looked at as holding this up. So the more information that people have about some of the components of this process, our clients have said the more streamlined and efficient their organization has become as a result. So with that being said, these three areas that you see in front of you are going to be the main areas we dive into today. We're going to talk a little bit about a certificate of insurance. I know everybody has seen them and is familiar with them. I'm not sure how many people are insurance nerds like myself and have taken the time to actually go through some of the finer details that are pretty important to understand. Next, we'll talk about just a couple of the commonly required additional coverages that you see in your client contracts as well as ultimately on a certificate of insurance, and talk a little bit about what they mean and what their impact to you as an organization is. And lastly, everybody's favorite topic, indemnification wording in contracts. I am not an attorney, but we can absolutely help everybody understand the application of different types of indemnification wording the way that it relates to their insurance contracts and also to their business. So with that being said, we'll dive right into the meat of this here. Certificates of Insurance Basics. So everybody is looking right now at an Accord 25. An Accord 25 is a certificate of liability, which is the most common type of certificate that we see out there. It's the most common because what it does is reference a snapshot in time of coverages that you have in place for a third party. In the case of today's conversation, that third party is going to be your client or your prospective client. So before we dive into what a certificate is, we're actually going to start with what a certificate of insurance is not. And when you look at the very top box of the certificate of liability, you find out exactly what it is not. And this is something, again, that I don't know how many people have read through, but we're going to take the time right now to go through it and talk about what it means. So the certificate is issued as a matter of information only and confers no rights upon the certificate holder. This certificate does not affirmatively or negatively amend, extend, or alter the coverage afforded by the policies below. The certificate of insurance does not constitute a contract between the issuing insurers, authorized representative or producer, and the certificate holder. Wow. So a translation of that is a certificate of insurance can be pretty useless document when it comes to what it actually means in the court of law. That being said, you're certainly better off having certificates of insurance that are issued correctly so that you're not left with a stumbling block if you ever find yourself in a courtroom situation. But again, it is important to understand that at the end of the day, a certificate of insurance is worthless from a legal perspective. But what it does do is it gives a third party a snapshot of what coverages are in place, the effective dates of those coverages, and some of the basic limits as really a representation of the policies that were issued for you as a staffing company. Some of the other important areas of a certificate of insurance, the cancellation clause. So once upon a time, every insurance carrier used to tweak the cancellation language that you'd appear on a certificate to be customizable. Today, as you will see from the cancellation clause on a certificate, at the bottom right of the page, it says, should any of the above described policies be canceled before the expiration date thereof, notice will be delivered in accordance with the policy provisions. So again, you've got a significant component of a certificate of insurance that really doesn't tell you anything. It just simply says, hey, whatever the policy says is what we may do. So we're now spending significant amount of time on something that in a lot of cases doesn't mean anything, but there are lots of other areas where it means plenty, and that's what we're going to transition into now. So as we look forward to the purpose of what a certificate actually does, again, it confirms the coverage that exists. It's validation from a third party that the policies are enforced that your client is asking for. So it's very important in the client's eyes to be able to represent that some way. It also provides the carrier information. So sometimes clients are very sensitive to having an A-rated carrier or higher. This is where if you've got a sharp risk manager on the other end at a client, they're going to see it. They could potentially see a name that doesn't fit their contractual requirement from a carrier rating standpoint. But one of the most important areas of a certificate of insurance comes in with the last bullet point here, where it's providing confirmation of the limits and additional endorsements that we're going to talk about a little bit further here today. Things like additional insured status, waiver of subrogation. It will appear on a certificate as requested by the client contract. But again, as we just went through, just because it appears on a certificate stating somebody's an additional insured doesn't mean that's what the policy language in place actually says. So getting back to this, to the kind of worthlessness of a certificate on one hand, just because it says, again, some kind of additional language on there doesn't mean the policies behind the scenes mirror that. But big picture purpose of a certificate of insurance is some form of third-party validation. I would also tell you that at this point, you know, things to look out for, especially if you're a staffing company that finds itself in a contractual relationship, like a secondary supplier relationship, maybe a VMS relationship, or something where you've got a third party to the contract. If you ever see a certificate of insurance and it's got whiteout on it, that's generally not a good sign. Believe it or not, people will try to doctor up certificates of insurance to slide through requirements. And so anytime you see that evidence of that, not a good thing. And another area where you just want to make sure you're asking questions is not necessarily good, bad, or indifferent, but if you see somebody else other than the first named insured listed on a certificate of insurance. So, for example, if you were expecting to see ABC Staffing Company as the first named insured in the top box of the certificate and it's not on there, then you probably just want to ask some more questions to understand what kind of relationship is in place there. So the certificates that we're starting with are really a lot of times the end product of the process, and it's a topic that doesn't have a whole lot of substance on the surface, but as we get through this today, hopefully you'll understand why we spent a little bit of time just talking about some of the basic building blocks of the certificate of insurance. What we're going to do next is we're going to look at the commonly required additional coverages that we see in contracts and try to understand a little bit about their impact to your business as well as to your insurance program. So one of the most commonly required additional coverages that everybody is going to be asked for in a contract is general liability. The important thing to note about general liability is very simply, it's responsible for third-party bodily injury or property damage, right? So that's not your employee getting hurt or not your property getting damaged. That's when you or your employee does damage to somebody else or somebody else's piece of property. So with that being the basic definition, here are the most standard amount of limits that we see in place. Most contracts are going to require $1 million per occurrence and a $2 million aggregate. What that means is you can have one $1 million accident, as that's an occurrence that would cap out at $1 million. You could have two of those accidents in one policy period because that aggregate is $2 million. But the moment you have a $1.5 million occurrence, you're going to have that top $500,000 not contemplated under this general liability policy. You better hope you've got an umbrella or an excess policy over top. But these next three terms are the terms that we most often see with contracts and what we're going to spend a little bit more time going into. So most of the time we're seeing additional insured status being required under general liability. A lot of times we see primary and non-contributory wording being requested, and we also see waiver of subrogation being requested. So what do each of those terms mean? Additional insured. So when you grant somebody additional insured status, you are essentially extending your policy to them. So that's a lot of power and a lot of access that you're granting somebody when you give them that status. So we better understand how additional insured status is done the right way and when additional insured status could be potential risk in your business. So when additional insured is done right, what it does is it reinforces exactly what you agreed to in your contract. So that can be a positive thing. It thus would give the additional insured the direct rights under your policy, as well as give the additional insured direct rights to defense from your carrier. So again, some of those things can be good if that is what your intention is in your contract. So an example of when that would be good is if in your contract you agree to indemnify and hold harmless your client when you do anything wrong, right? Sole negligence, an example of, let's say your employee jumps into a forklift, and while operating that forklift, that employee either injures one of your client's employees who's standing on the floor or damages property that's your client's property. In either one of those instances, your client's going to look at you and say, hey, staffing company, in our contract, you agreed that if you did something wrong, if you were negligent, you're going to extend additional insured status to us, and you're going to indemnify and hold us harmless. Well, if by doing that, what you're going to do is you're going to have a claims department at a carrier receive a claim in, and it's going to state exactly what happened, that there was an accident, that our staffing employee was negligent, and they inadvertently injured somebody or damaged property. And your best case scenario as a staffing company with a client that's upset about a situation is that that claims adjuster strokes a check and pays this thing out very quickly, not a lot of questions, not a lot of distractions, right? And if you have a contract that's clear, and if you got additional insured status under the general liability policy that reinforces that contractual arrangement, that's exactly what will happen. So where do some issues come in play? Well, with additional insured status, the top two bullet points you see there are really carrier issues, where they look at it and they say, you know, it's impossible for us to evaluate the exposure we're taking on. Here you are, staffing company, adding, you know, 40 new clients a year as an additional insured, and we're not charging premium for those clients. The other carrier kind of focus on additional insured status is that, again, they're receiving, your clients are receiving free coverage in that moment, and that's not premium that they're necessarily contemplating on an individual basis. More importantly, though, when you've got additional insured status as a staffing company, some issues can arise because you're providing access to your limits to that additional insured. So what happens if, let's say, there's a year where you have a couple of bad things happen, and the first thing that happens is pretty catastrophic, and you end up exhausting your policy on that first incident, and it's your client as additional insured who burns up most of the defense costs, who gets indemnified, and all of a sudden you've got, you know, lightning strikes twice and you've got another bad incident that takes place shortly thereafter. You might find yourself in a spot where this insurance policy that you've paid a lot of money for has no dollars left to respond. So that obviously wouldn't be a good thing. The other thing that's not a good thing is if you've got, you know, in the example that we just talked about, when an additional insured is done right, you're kind of adding belts and suspenders to that, to the contract behind the scenes, right? We talked about a smooth claims handling process and a check being cut very quickly and efficiently. Well, if you've got additional insured status that, let's say, for example, is doing the exact opposite of what your contract says. So, you know, you're supposed to be in a position where you're taking on all of your clients' liability, no matter what. But your insurance contract says that additional insured status only applies if you, the staffing company, have some form of negligence as well. Then you've got a situation where the two contracts, the insurance contract and your business contract, aren't in alignment. And what you're going to find is you're going to have some pretty upset people, including yourself, including your client, because the ability to remedy that situation is not in place. Again, we've got a gap between the two different contracts here. So we'll get into some of the indemnification terms and examples in a little bit. But when we come back to it and we talk about additional insured status done right and additional insured issues, they're the two examples I would want you to think of. Moving on to the next key coverage term, waivers of subrogation. So when you issue a waiver of subrogation, what it means is that your insurance carrier cannot go back and collect from a third party, even if that third party was completely negligent. Okay? So an example of this, we're jumping ahead a little bit, but an example of this on the workers' compensation side is if you've got an employee who's in a manufacturing setting and you've agreed to provide a waiver of subrogation to your client. That client decides to take a machine guard off to speed up production, and your employee ends up cutting off fingers or cutting off a hand because your client made a poor decision to increase production and not think about the safety ramifications of that. In that instance, your insurance carrier, as well as you, are probably going to look at that situation and say, well, that's just plain wrong. My client should have never made a decision to put my employee in that unsafe position, all because they were worried about the speed of production and increased revenues. So what you're going to find yourself with is a situation where you might want to go back and recoup damages that have taken place under workers' compensation because your client was wrong, but you've extended a waiver of subrogation which would prohibit your carrier from going back and recovering under your client. So, again, some of those things that you just need to be careful of what you're doing. Sometimes it's a business decision to understand issuing a waiver of subrogation might leave your ability, if your carrier's ability to collect non-existent, and if you're in any kind of loss-sensitive program, might mean that it's really your ability, your money, that's hanging out there, and you can't go collect that if there's a waiver of subrogation that's extended. So, this slide is basically just reinforcing what I said there. And again, there's no right or wrong when it comes to issuing a waiver of subrogation. It's a lot of times the cost of doing business, or can be the cost of doing business. We always just advise our clients that you should just understand when you've got that opportunity to make a business decision of, yes, I'm going to extend this, or no, I'm not going to extend this. And if you decide to do it because that's what you need to get the contract closed, then, you know, that's your business risk and decision to make there. The last key term that we'll talk about under the general liability policy is something called primary and non-contributory wording. You'll find this requested a lot of times in that contract as well. And what this says is that your insurance policy will respond first and will not look for any other insurance policy to respond unless you maybe exhaust your limits, and then they'll look for somebody else's insurance policy to respond. So An example of this is, again, every one of your clients, we're going to assume, has their own insurance in place. And when something bad happens, lots of times you're going to reach out to your insurance broker, and your insurance broker is going to send something into your insurance carrier. Sometimes you may need to start defense of a claim. Sometimes you might have investigative costs, whatever. When you have primary and non-contributory wording in your contract, what it does is reaffirm that you as the staffing company, all of those initial costs just to set up a claim are immediately going to your policy and not your clients. Again, nothing that's ever right or wrong in that situation, just want everybody to have an understanding of what primary and non-contributory wording actually means when they see it requested on a cert and how it functions. So switching gears just a little bit, the next coverage that we're going to talk about is your workers' compensation policy. And within your workers' compensation policy, you've got two actual different types of coverages being provided. The first one is workers' compensation. The second one is employer's liability. And very simply, the workers' compensation is there to provide your injured employee with benefits at the time of injury. It could also provide for a lost time and on top of those benefits versus the employer's liability is an area of the policy that is in place for reasons other than just somebody got hurt and a benefit needs to be triggered. There's a couple of different areas under employer's liability. It's not a very common type of claim, but one type of claim could be when you've got a third party action over claim or translation, when your client is sued by your injured employee, and we all are in agreement that workers' compensation should be the sole remedy there. One possible role of employer's liability portion of the policy would be to be able to defend and potentially get your client out of any kind of suit there. When we look at what the policy actually provides, a lot of people have a misconception of the fact that workers' compensation has a $1 million limit, and that's actually not the case. The employer's liability portion of the policy is the only portion of the policy that has a dollar limit attached to it. On the workers' compensation side, it's, as it says, they're statutory limits. So some states have no limit. The limit is endless. Other states have things like a scheduled payout system on percentages and different ways of calculating what type of injury produces what kind of benefit for an injured worker. So the takeaway here is that, again, workers' compensation doesn't have any limits attached to it in the policy. It's whatever the state may dictate. When we talk about the workers' compensation policy, one of the most common requested coverage that's out there is the alternate employer endorsement. And before we jump into the alternate employer endorsement, it should be noted that additional insured status does not exist for workers' compensation. That is often something, again, that's requested, even though the insurance doesn't exist. So no additional insured status under workers' compensation. There are waivers of subrogation on workers' compensation, as we've talked about previously, and that's a additional coverage that you want to understand and understand when you're providing it to your clients. But the other form of additional coverage that is most often requested, especially in the staffing world, is this alternate employer endorsement. And you see the formal definition in front of you. I'm not going to read that, but essentially what this coverage does is it reinforces the relationship that's in place and confirms that your employees if they get injured, they're under your workers' compensation policy, right? Staffing is a unique industry where we've got work sites that are, you know, habitated by different parties. Your employees, your client's employees are kind of in cohabitation there. This endorsement exists by that very fact, so that, again, we've got a clarifying relationship in place saying, nope, my employees as a staffing firm, if they get hurt, they're under my policy. All right, so for the last portion of the conversation today, we're going to weave our way into indemnification wording, talk about the three different types of wording that we see in contracts, reinforce some of the pitfalls, reinforce some of the ways it's done well. But again, just like we started with the certificates of insurance, hopefully as a building block to the culmination of this conversation, those additional coverages and some of the specific endorsements that we just talked about hopefully serve as a building block as we get to the final chapter here in really where the rubber meets the road. So I'm not going to sit here and read you the definition of a contract, but I do think that one of the most important slides and understandings in this presentation is, what is a goal of a contract, right? And to start with, maybe, I know that every staffing firm has their own contract, and we all want our clients to sign our own contract, because chances are your labor attorney as well as your insurance broker have reviewed that contract, and they have told you that you're in best practices with that contract. And you know that at the end of the day, every business relationship that you get into, you can sleep well at night knowing that you're not taking on any inherent risk that you're not aware of. Well, that game changes a lot of times when we get our client contract in, right? And certainly this is very, very prevalent in the VMS, MSP type world. It's also very prevalent when you talk about, you know, the Fortune 500, Fortune 1000 type size companies. But we all know we also see it from time to time with some of the folks down the road that you wouldn't expect to see a big, you know, 30-page complicated contract from. So that's why I say that this is one of the more important slides. You know, can't stress enough that when we're faced with that situation of having to evaluate whether to sign a client contract or not, then it becomes your responsibility to really tear through that contract and understand exactly what you're agreeing to. So I don't care if you're unclear on the insurance requirements part. Certainly I know payment terms and bill rates you guys are going to get clear on, right? We want to get paid, and we want to get paid the right way. But the same thing is true when it comes to indemnification and insurance. If you've got questions, if you think that the contract is too one-sided in any direction, your responsibility as an owner of a staffing company or whatever your role within your company is to get clear on what those duties and responsibilities are, and more importantly, what could they mean to the organization if something bad happens. Right? So we want a clear understanding of, if something bad happens, what kind of risk am I looking at? So the next couple pages are just a couple of basic definitions and reference material that comes into play when we talk about contracts. So you've got hold harmless wording, and you've got some definitions of the what it means to be indemnitor versus indemnity. I think the important part to note about this reference material is that, the hold harmless, for example, that's what you're giving to your client, right? When you agree to hold someone harmless, that's a pretty broad word. So our job is to understand the limitations that are put in to that phrase of hold harmless. And we do that by looking at the contract, looking at the wording, and being able to identify exactly what some of those limitations might be. And these reference terms, again, are really just setting the stage for the understanding of the different types of indemnification language. So we're going to zero in right now on the three different types of indemnification language that we see. The first form, broad form. ABC Staffing Company agrees to indemnify and hold harmless XYZ client for any and all claims that arise from or in connection with this contract. So the very first thing that we teach our staffing practice group here, the team members on the service side, is when you see the words any and all in a contract, it does not get any more broad than that. The translation, the simple translation of this page is you're on the hook for anything under the sun, right? It's literally that broad. So we've all seen indemnification wording that mimics what this says here. We probably, chances are, have all made decisions to sign contracts that have this kind of indemnification wording. And again, that's fine. That is your business decision to do so. Our kind of collective rule that we have with our clients is if you're going to do that, just understand when you're doing it and understand the risk that is that you're taking on as a result. Okay, because again, you may find yourself in a situation where you spend all this money on insurance contracts, you sign one business contract that has poor indemnification wording in it, and all of a sudden those insurance contracts aren't worth a whole lot at the end of the day based off of an onerous contract that you've signed here. So let's look at the second form of indemnification. The intermediate form is one where the language looks pretty similar to what we said before. ABC Staffing Company agrees to indemnify and hold harmless XYZ client for any and all claims that arise from or in connection with this contract, except for those caused by sole negligence of XYZ. Well, there were those terms, any and all, right, which we've already talked about as a red flag. But the big difference here, as we talked about with the definition of hold harmless, is that all of a sudden we've got a limiter in place with the word except, right? We're automatically taking a portion of the previous phrase out and carving out an exception to say, except for those caused by sole negligence of XYZ. And that's significant. When you take indemnification language from broad form, again, anything under the sun, to intermediate, where it says anything under the sun except for when you, client, are solely negligent, then you've narrowed the scope of risk that you're taking on tremendously. Is there still risk, inherent risk out there that you're exposed to because we don't have full mutual indemnification in place? There is. But again, you've greatly mitigated it because now anything that your client, you know, going back to that manufacturing example we used before, where if you sign a contract where your client removes a guard of a machine to increase production, and there's something bad happens as a result, well, you're going to pull out this contract and your claims adjuster that's fighting on your behalf and your broker that's fighting on your behalf is going to pull out this contract and they're going to say, wait a minute, we said we hold our client harmless except for instances caused by their sole negligence. We as the staffing company not having any supervisory or directional role of the employee in your setting are not responsible for your sole negligence, client, and thus there's nothing that is going to blow back to us as a result of this. In fact, it's the exact opposite, where hopefully your taking this language and kind of flipping it backwards, and best practices would say, you know, have your client then have indemnification wording that says XYZ client will hold harmless and indemnify ABC staffing company in the event of XYZ client sole negligence, right? Because that really drives clarity to the contract at that point. We've got not just one form of indemnification, but we've got a secondary form that's flipping this around and reinforcing it. So the question that you're left with is, what about claims where both parties have some degree of negligence, right? In this example, your client has to be solely negligent in order for your contract to kind of get you out of the situation. Well, that's where the last form of indemnification comes into play, and that's the limited form of indemnification, where it says ABC Staffing Company agrees to indemnify and hold harmless XYZ client for any and all claims that arise from or in connection with this contract to the extent caused by ABC's negligence, right? So we're no longer limiting, well, first of all, it's not any and all anymore, right? It's not that under the sun, everything under the sun verbiage that we saw in the broad form. But we're not just limiting it to sole negligence like the intermediate form is. We're now saying, no, we're responsible for whatever we do wrong, and you're responsible for whatever you do wrong, client company, right? Because we're saying the extent caused by our negligence. And again, just as I mentioned on the previous slide, best practices would say that you've got mutual indemnification in place, which takes this exact phrase, flips it upside down, and reinforces your client obligation there. So not all states will rule in contributory or in comparative fashion, meaning some states won't split 60-40, 90-10, but it's still best practices to have this type of verbiage in there, because even if your state won't split things, a lot of times you're left at least not holding the bag completely. So again, to reinforce the examples we talked about in those two latter forms of indemnification, we want to really force mutual indemnification, because that is the way that we get clear, and that's the way that we're confident that we've got a pretty good idea of what's going to happen when something bad happens. We understand our risk. We understand our client's risk. There's no gray area. I don't know how many folks on the line are part of the American Staffing Association. The American Staffing Association, as you know, one of our best governing bodies and frames of reference for best practices, puts out a general staffing agreement. We always look at the general staffing agreement that I've included an excerpt of here, and refer folks to the indemnification and limitation of liability section in paragraphs 9 through 13. This is a perfect example of mutual indemnification. Without reading all of this, you can clearly see that in line 9, it's putting out there what the staffing firm will do. And in line 10, we're now, again, taking kind of the inverse of that, and we're saying, and this is what the client will do. So what we accomplish, once again, we've got no gray areas. We've got complete understanding of who's responsible for what when it comes to insurance and indemnification. So this is a great example of the benefit that ASA membership can provide with reference material like this. We point to this often with our clients. So indemnification versus insurance. Hopefully what you've learned here today is that the two are very much related. They weave in and out of each other, but that it all starts from managing the indemnification language in your contracts. If you are not paying attention to the indemnification language in your contract, you could have a great insurance policy that costs you a whole lot of money every year and find yourself in a position where it doesn't mean anything because, again, you signed a contract that provide is kind of a giant gap or a big air ball in between the language that's in your insurance contract. So when we talk about insurance and indemnification, some of my clients, you know, sometimes you'll get the question of, hey, is giving additional insured status bad here? Is that a bad idea? Is giving a waiver a bad idea? I can't answer that question unless I first look at your insurance, or I'm sorry, your indemnification requirements in your contract. So again, I'm not going to read every bullet point here, but to reiterate that when you've got limited form indemnification, you have established that you're not taking on any additional liability. That is, that's our best case scenario. We understand fully what we're at risk for. We understand fully what our client is at risk for. So what I'll leave you with here today is that, again, it all starts with that indemnification language. Your responsibility as a staffing company is to push back if it's not acceptable language, to force your client to redline things. More often than not, you will get movement out of a client's risk and legal department when it comes to contracts. I'm not saying you're going to get everything you want, but this is your one and only time to go ahead and try to get what you want. Your insurance broker should be able to help you with that. That's an active part of what our service team does every day for our clients, is helping on the contract review and helping kind of translate and understand indemnification language. It's hugely important for the success of your company, and make sure that you don't have something come out of left field someday that you're not expecting, all because you signed a contract that has onerous terms on it. Additionally, when the right contracts are in place and the right indemnification language is in place, adding a lot of those additional insurance coverages that we spoke about, like additional insured, is a non-issue. It's belts and suspenders. It's actually a favorable thing because it ensures that what you agreed in the contract to happen is going to happen at the time of a claim. And then, you know, again, just some closing thoughts of really in a business partnership, you know, hopefully we're in a situation where we never have to take on the liability of another just to do business. Look at those contracts closely, understand that. Have a decision-making hierarchy within the company to make sure that your sales force understands a little bit of basics on the indemnification language here. Make sure they understand that when they see certain language, let's kick it up the ladder, and let's make sure that anybody who's signing off on that kind of contract or language very much understands the risk they're signing off with at the same time. So that concludes the presentation today. 7 minutes to spare, which is good. Hopefully there are plenty of questions coming my way.
Okay, thank you very much. At this point, go ahead and enter any questions you have in the Q&A or the chat feature. I'm also going to open up a poll for you to give us your feedback. Please take the time to do that. And while we're waiting for any questions that have come in, Tony, can you talk about any specific questions that you frequently receive in your office from staffing clients that you might be able to cover?
Sure. I think that one of the biggest ones that we receive, because so many of our clients take risk in their program, revolves around that waiver of subrogation on the workers' compensation side, something that we touched on in this presentation, where they will say, you know, is giving waiver of subrogation a bad thing here? And what our job is to do is, again, reiterate, there's no good or bad in operating a business. They're simply educated business decisions to make. But when you're in a loss-sensitive insurance program where you're taking risk, the dynamic is much different than when you're not taking risk, because it's not the insurance carrier's money that you're giving away or you're giving the opportunity to not collect if something goes wrong, it's your own money. And a lot of time those retentions, you know, are anywhere from $100,000 of risk to upwards to $500,000 or higher of risk. So can be a very important distinction to make in just making sure that the dots are connected from the staffing company to understand when they issue some of these additional coverages how much money is truly potentially at stake sometimes.
Some of the common questions we get from clients, or I see at least with clients and as they're working with a prospect, where a prospect is specifically asking for higher levels of insurance coverage in certain areas than maybe what the staffing company originally has set up for themselves. Can you speak to that at all, or ideas or suggestions when they come across that with a particular entity?
Absolutely. Good question, and a popular one as well from our end. I would suggest that the very first place you look when that is pushed back to you is to make sure that the end user is looking at your umbrella policy and the limits that are contained in that umbrella policy. Because more often than not, the combination of the underlying general liability or professional liability policy plus the umbrella limits are more than enough to suffice in covering those additional limits that they're looking for. Very rarely will they specifically say, no, it needs to be over and above. So that would be the first place I look. The second place I would look is that on some coverages, I know crime is a popular one here, some coverages and carriers will actually allow you to get a contract-specific endorsement where if you do have to buy higher limits, let's say the contract's requiring you to take your crime limits from $1 million to $5 million, you're at least not paying premium on your entire exposure base, but the carrier will be able to underwrite you on that one specific client and the exposure that is associated with that client. So that can be a big money saver as well. And then the last piece is push back. Again, you would be surprised to see how often these groups start with higher limits or request higher limits, but at the end of the day, will settle on something lower.
Great. The last question that I have is related to that certificate of insurance where you had some language on that first page that talks about the cancellation. Now, many clients, customers will require a certificate of insurance be sent with them listed as a certificate holder. Is there anything with that cancellation clause that's on that document that has anything to do with whether or not that entity would receive a notice of cancellation or, you know, what the purpose behind that would be?
Yeah, so it's really an antiquated issue in the insurance world, meaning that years ago you used to be able to specify that if coverage is canceled, a certificate holder would receive a cancellation notice from a third-party carrier. The reality is that insurance companies were losing a whole lot of money mailing out a bunch of cancellations, and so they started to amend the language to, one, not put any kind of time limit in place, and then, two, end up today where you end up, which is, again, giving a very broad cancellation clause that tells your certificate holder nothing about how your policy is going to respond. So the end answer is it all comes back to your policy, but I will tell you very few policies this day and age will ever send out cancellation to certificate holders, especially for something like material change.
Okay, yeah, because I think that's typically why they're asking for it, my guess, other than just seeing the limits, but to literally have themselves named as a certificate holder. I'm assuming it's mostly related to trying to be aware of, like, the workers' comp, for example.
Correct.
Okay. Do we have any other final thoughts that you'd like to share with the audience today before we end today's session?
I would, again, really encourage you to utilize your broker as a good resource to help you look at contracts and get feedback on contracts. Educate your sales force on this concept. Make sure that they understand that they can help this process move slowly. They can close more deals faster with a better, healthier understanding of this stuff. Hopefully, at the end of the day, contracts and insurance never hold up a deal, and you guys can grow your business in a more efficient manner.
I've gone ahead and placed the contact information up on the screen here. Please feel free to reach out to either myself or directly if you have additional questions or would like some more information as it relates to insurance coverages. Thank you again for joining us, and Tony, thank you for sharing your knowledge on contractual insurance awareness for the sales process. Look for information on our next webinar session. We'll continue to post these on our website. We will have a recording available in the coming days on TRICOM's website in the Industry Insider Webinar Series section. Thank you again, and have a wonderful day.
Thanks so much, Amanda.
Thank you.